There's a strategic basis for the arms race right now. There's no real strategic basis for disarmament. We have not, as a people, offered clear alternatives to the current arms race. I think that's why I believe the freeze is important as a first step. That's why I believe the comprehensive test ban is important as a very small step. The question of how we in a safe way, reduce nuclear weapons in such a way that we don't create an unstable environment that makes nuclear war more rather than less likely. That question has not been resolved. It has not been resolved by the U.S. government. It's not been resolved by the Soviet government. I think it's more likely to be resolved by the public.
Jane Wales is National Executive Director of Physicians for Social Responsibility. She is a former Associate Director of the Committee for National Security, former Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Public Affairs, and Coordinator of the Public Liaison Committee at the White House. Today, Ms. Wales shares some of her central views on the quest for peace. In thinking about concrete actions that will lead to peace in a safer world, one of the ones you singled out is the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty. Why?
I think it's time that we stopped haggling over the outputs of the nuclear arms race while pursuing each new technological temptation that comes our way, such as MIRVT missiles, such as specifically right now the MX, such as a strategic defense, and instead get at the process of the arms race. Basically, stop the arms race at the starting gate. Let's not risk getting to the finishing line. I think it's very achievable. A comprehensive test ban, a ban on all nuclear explosions, has been the stated goal of the Soviet and American governments since the mid-50s. It's a trilateral negotiation involving the United Kingdom as well. I think there's significant public support for it. It's been largely negotiated under the Carter administration with General Secretary Brezhnev. I think if there is the political will under the Reagan administration and the Gorbachev leadership in the Soviet Union, we could pursue it and achieve it.
One advantage of not having a comprehensive test ban treaty is that weapons can continue to be modernized and new ones developed. Since the stated goal is to make them safer and more reliable, why isn't that an argument to not have that particular test?
Modernization of nuclear weaponry is not, in my view, a positive thing. Modernization means building new, more accurate, more destructive, more powerful nuclear weapons. Since we know that we would not survive in any meaningful sense a nuclear war, a nuclear exchange, we know that these are not usable nuclear weapons. There is no advantage to adding more powerful nuclear weapons to the stockpiles. It's a disadvantage on both sides. I think you've probably heard the old tale that the nuclear arms race is very much like having two teenagers standing in a basement waist-deep in gasoline, and one's got 5 matches and the other's got 7, and you ask yourself, which one is going to have the advantage if he gets yet another? Modernization is not in a nuclear arms race a positive thing.
Second reason that you supported the comprehensive test ban is its effects on nuclear proliferation.
Yeah.
How will that work?
The nuclear non-proliferation treaty signed in 1968 obligated the signatories to seek a comprehensive test ban. until 1981, the signatories were seeking a comprehensive test ban. They've stopped. The administration has chosen not to resume talks. The result is that we are in the process of undermining that non-proliferation treaty because we're not abiding by Article 6 of that treaty. That is causing concern amongst non-nuclear states who signed on to the non-proliferation treaty. On a more positive side, there are non-nuclear states, or I should say near-nuclear states, who have indicated that if the U.S. and the Soviet Union got serious about abiding by Article 6, i.e., got serious about pursuing a comprehensive test ban, they would sign on to the non-proliferation treaty.
Is it verifiable?
A comprehensive test ban? The U.S. and the Soviets thought so. It's being challenged for the first time in a serious way in the current political environment. I believe that on-site inspection is an important component of a comprehensive test ban. The Soviet Union agreed to on-site inspection under challenges during the negotiations during the Carter administration. I think we should pursue that.
For states that don't have nuclear weapons, with proliferation being a danger in the decades ahead, such a treaty would have what provisions, in your view, that would prevent states that don't have them from developing them?
Well, one of the great advantages of a comprehensive test ban is it's a multilateral treaty. It's not just a bilateral treaty. Right now, there are three participants, or there have been three participants in the negotiations, but the treaty is designed, the process is designed to allow other states to follow on, to sign. Since we can verify down to 1 kiloton of, you know, a test of 1 kiloton, there's really, there's too high a risk of being caught in abrogating that treaty, number one, too high a price to pay. Well, you're too likely to be caught, let's put it that way. But secondly, if you don't test, it would be quite foolish to be pouring significant amounts of money into the development of weapons which you've never tested. There's just an enormous disincentive.
Countries that don't have nuclear weapons exist as we do in a world without a firm rule of law. Some nuclear states, such as France, have chosen not to sign a treaty, and there are other countries that are aspiring to have weapons that have given no sign that they would even sign a comprehensive test ban treaty. What are potential enforcement provisions?
I think the only way you can inspire other nations to sign is to be serious yourself. That question is premature when the superpowers are unwilling to complete that treaty. I think we ought to put it to the test. I think the treaty should be signed, the negotiation should be completed, the treaties should be signed, ratified in our case, and then we put it to the we invite the international community to join. I think you have to look back at the success of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, which indeed inspired over 100 signatures. We've got no reason to believe the CTB would be different.
Second general focus that you've offered to make the world safer is to preserve the ABM Treaty. You quoted the Scowcroft Commission as saying it's one of our finest and most reliable treaties that have served to make the world safer. Why is that? What will it do?
Essentially, what the anti-ballistic missile treaty did was deny the superpowers the opportunity to seriously pursue what's called defensive nuclear weaponry. That limited the arms race to an offensive nuclear arms race. We're now faced with some challenges to that treaty on both sides. of the arms race. We're concerned about a radar station that the Soviets have erected that would appear to be in violation. We hope the Soviets will explain or dismantle that radar. On the U.S. side, the Strategic Defense Initiative proposes an array of defensive weaponry which would be outside the limits of the Anti-Ballistic Missile Treaty. What this boils down to is let me back up. One of the greatest concerns of people who have been involved in arms control and disarmament has been the prevention of a twin arms race, a defensive-offensive arms race, which is, in many people's view, the single most destabilizing situation that could emerge. The Anti-Ballistic Missile Treaty prevents that. To apply it to current times, we're now looking for significant reductions in nuclear weapons. That's a stated policy of the U.S. government as we enter the Geneva talks. This is an important goal. The American public is behind it. I think the world public opinion is behind the notion of significant reductions. However, if you have a sword, you're not likely to throw that sword away if your adversary has just erected a shield and has maintained a sword as well. It's our belief that the erection of a shield, that this defensive system, this introduction of defensive systems, provides a disincentive for reducing the offensive weaponry on the other side, makes arms control impossible.
For you, reducing the number of weapons is a significant act.
Yes.
What needs to happen to begin that process?
I think we have to, what needs to happen, I think you've hit upon the most important thing, is the reaffirmation of the Anti-Ballistic Missile Treaty. I think both sides have got to agree that we're not going to mix offensive and defensive weaponry and bargain from that position. I think that the development of defensive weaponry stands in the way of reductions of offensive weaponry. So I hope that both sides will abide by the treaty, will in fact reaffirm and strengthen that treaty. Where there are loopholes, let's close them.
The history of arms control is that we seldom curtail weapon systems that we've already got in place. Is your view of the treaty keeping weapons off the seabeds, out of Antarctic, one that has worked?
I think that we've got varying standards, and one of our problems is that our standards have not remained the same. It has been difficult to pursue bilateral negotiations as we change our goals as a people and as a government. The initial purpose of arms control was to overcome some of the adverse consequences of technology. There are certain kinds of technology which are more provocative, that are more likely to produce nuclear war than to deter against nuclear war. That was the initial purpose of arms control. That was a limited goal, but it was a worthy goal, an important goal. That was the goal of SALT I. That was the goal of SALT II. We now have a larger goal. Our goal has gone beyond simply managing the arms race, keeping it in control, and has moved to reversing the arms race. That's an important, more ambitious approach, and a worthy approach. Now the question is, do we know how to get there? And that's where we come back to this question of defensive weaponry. It is my view that the introduction of defensive weaponry is in direct contradiction to the goal of reductions.
The history of arms control, whether it would have been a decision to ban multiple independently targeted reentry vehicles or the development of the hydrogen bomb, choices that were before the democracy at one time were made one way, and it's been argued that the world would be safer if a different decision had been made at the time. You're arguing we have another watershed choice before us, which is to preserve the ABM treaty and not militarize space, try a defensive shield, whether over our missiles or our populations. Given your belief that this is a watershed set of choices before the democracy, why is it that arms control is so misunderstood?
I'm not sure it is misunderstood. I do think that there is that sense that it's inadequate. The sense that you suggest when you say that it's a history of missed opportunities, it certainly is. It absolutely is. When President Kennedy achieved a limited test ban, he had to give up the goal of a comprehensive test ban. He felt he had to in order to achieve that. And in SALT I, we chose not to limit MIRV missiles, as you suggest. In SALT II, we chose not to limit cruise missiles in order to achieve that treaty, in order to achieve public support in this country for that treaty. We chose not to give up the MX, for example. In the START negotiations, we chose not to give up single warhead missiles, the Midget Man. We have introduced new weapons as we've gone along, and that has been one of the unfortunate parts of the process. I think there was the answer to that is deepening public understanding of the negotiating process. The poll after poll will show you that the American public believes in arms control, always has, believes in arms reductions, believes that we've got to improve our relations with our adversaries, particularly the Soviet Union, believes you can negotiate with the Soviet Union. But where the public will disagree is on the question of exactly how. Will the introduction of the MX improve chances for reductions in nuclear weapons? Or will it decrease chances? Those are questions that are not so clearly answerable, I think.
Okay, let's take, though, the three treaties that have been negotiated under three different presidents, signed by both the Soviet Union and the United States, and then not ratified by the Senate. And the Senate, as a representative group elected by the people, having to look at it to see if it's in our national interest, has determined that it's not. How does that happen?
I'm not sure if they've determined it's not in our national interest or that they've determined it's not in their own political interest. We have an interesting system in which a minority can destroy the prospects for a treaty. You have to have two-thirds of the Senate to ratify. It's not a majority vote. You have to have two-thirds. That is to say that slightly more than one-third of the Senate can destroy prospects for a treaty. So we have a system by which the minority can stop a treaty. During the SALT II debate, the public opinion poll showed that the majority view was that this was in our interest and it should be pursued. However, a very vocal minority was able to inspire sufficient opposition to make ratification unlikely.
You've written,
all you need is 34 senators.
Okay. You've written that one of the problems we have in arms control treaties or in the nuclear arms race itself is that we don't get at the root causes of the competition. What are those?
It is natural to think that more weapons make you stronger. If you're having a fight of sticks and stones, more sticks and stones do make you stronger. Nuclear weapons are something different. They're a whole different order of weapon. In fact, I think weapon's a very bad word in describing nuclear devices. They do not give advantage to the person using them, to the country using them. All the nuclear winter studies demonstrate, which have been reconfirmed, demonstrate to us that it is national suicide to launch a nuclear war. the threat of retaliation is real, but there is also the real factor that you will so upset the ecological balance that your own nation will be drastically affected by any, not just a nuclear exchange, just the launching of a nuclear attack. So we're in a situation where we're not dealing with good old-fashioned weapons, and we can't use good old-fashioned attitudes in approaching their development and their use.
Nuclear weapons are ultimately inanimate, and you said it's a problem in human behavior. How do you go about changing it?
Changing human attitudes is that's the hardest, that's the longest task there is. You're an educator. You understand the significance of education, and then you understand that it is not a one-day or a one-week task. It's a lifetime task. We're all in the process of educating ourselves throughout our lives. I think that the single most important thing we can achieve is a state in which we are perpetually educating ourselves as citizens as to the nature of this arms race, as to the ways in which we can reverse it. I think we need to achieve basically a permanent mobilization for an end to the arms race, a permanent mobilization for peace.
As a product of the type of education you're calling for, an ongoing process, what do you want people to know that they don't know now?
There's a strategic basis for the arms race right now. There's no real strategic basis for disarmament. We have not, as a people, offered clear alternatives to the current arms race. I think that's why I believe the freeze is important as a first step. That's why I believe the comprehensive test ban is important as a very small step. The question of how we, in a safe way, reduce nuclear weapons in such a way that we don't create an unstable environment that makes nuclear war more rather than less likely, that question has not been resolved. It has not been resolved by the U.S. government. It's not been resolved by the Soviet government. I think it's more likely to be resolved by the public.
Ultimately, two superpowers in this world have an awesome amount of destructive potential aimed at the other. And as you focused, it's a problem of human behavior and the need to change people. Your analysis applies to a democracy where you educate people and they will vote differently, and you've argued eloquently that this issue is too important to be left to the experts, that it is truly an issue before the democracy. But what about the issue in Russia, where it's not an issue before a democracy, where it's a closed society, and the people don't have a direct way to express their views? How do you make changes there?
I don't think it's necessary to make changes there. The Soviet government is going to act in what it perceives to be its own interests. I think you can trust them to do that. And arms control and reductions are clearly in the Soviet interests. They have, both sides have benefited from SALT I and from observing SALT II. I mean, you note that both sides chose to observe SALT II even though it was not ratified, because it's in their interests. It's not in either side's interest to have the arms race out of control. It keeps their military planners from being able to plan. It keeps a level of uncertainty that is very dangerous. It is economically totally unsound for both sides, very destructive for both sides, and I think you might find, since they have a less robust economy, that they might have even more concern than we about that aspect. So I'm not sure you need domestic political pressure in the Soviet Union in order to create an interest in pursuing arms control. I think we've seen you don't.
But one former Secretary of Defense has been quoted is saying, when we build, they build. When we stop, they build. How does that square with your analysis that it's in their interest at this time in history to not continue that pattern?
Yeah, I think that you can make that statement from the Soviet Union or from the United States. When the Soviets stop, we build also. What we both do is stretch the limits of a treaty. We both go exactly as far as the treaty allows us to go, and no less. That's the nature of the competition. I think we're getting back a little bit to human nature, and the nature of the way governments interact. But neither side has voluntarily elected to do less than the treaty allows. We have a tendency to mimic each other in this arms race. And that is a reality. That's why the treaties are important, because they determine those limits.
One part of your hope for making the world safer has been to translate new public understanding into policy change. Yet most Americans favor a bilateral freeze. We have not done that. Most Americans feel that it is possible to negotiate more with the Russians than we have done. What keeps the understanding from being translated into policy change?
I think that thus far we have not had an effective dialogue between the public and the policymakers. I think the policymakers have come to realize that there is public ferment out there, there's strong public concern, and strong public support for arms control and disarmament. The evidence of that is that President Reagan made a commitment during an election year to make disarmament his single highest priority. Secondly, I think that the public has become considerably more engaged in the policy process. Average citizens were calling their congressmen and senators, writing letters, sending telegrams about the MX vote. When I was in government, the MX was an issue, and there was no public expression, virtually none, except when it became an environmental question. But as when it was just simply a national security issue, this is 8 years ago, there was silence. That's changed. That's changed dramatically. But there does, you're correct in noting that there remains a gap between public concern and dramatic, fast, concrete policy change. That's not going to happen overnight. And part of the reason it's not going to happen overnight is that we haven't found a way to talk to each other. We haven't found the points of consensus yet between policymakers / experts and the citizen expert and the citizen activist.
Thank you for sharing with us today your insights into the ways to a more peaceful world.
Thank you.